Yo, what's going on? This is Jacob calling from London. I'm wearing a wizard hat. What time of day is it where you are? Right here, it's 6 p.m. The evening has fallen in the land of North London. It's dark outside. I just bought a Christmas tree with my family. Very exciting. How you doing? It's good to see you. I've been excited for this for a little while. I'm calling from my room in London. This is my room. In fact, I can show you my room for real, just like this. Let me see if I can do this. Okay, boom, here we go. So this is my room. I've just installed these exciting cameras in the room so you can have a look around. But call this your home for the next hour or so. We've got some exciting things to talk about. And there's me again. So I've got a little setup going on. So we're here to discuss the moon of rivers, the arrangement of Moon River, which I did back in May, and it was a bit of an adventure. I sat in this exact chair with the blue backdrop, and I sat here for a week and I didn't leave the room. And when I left the room, it was finished. It was a lot of work. It was really good fun. I explored a lot of harmonies that I'd never explored before, and I just kind of wanted to talk you through it, to deconstruct it a bit, and just to talk about how it worked, how it was to record it. And so I reckon we should just get straight to it. What do you reckon? Yeah? I can see the comments over here and they're kind of whizzing past, but I'll try and keep an eye on them if I can. So we're going to jump into the screen. And the screen goes a bit like this. So boom. Here we have it. We have the logic session of Moon River, color-coded for your delectation. And essentially there's a lot going on, but every single audio file is one of these little blips. So if you see these little blips right here, these are all audio files. And depending on what color the audio file is related, well, that's related to what folder they're in, like folder of tracks. So there are a few different buses going on. There's one pyramid bus, then there's the breath bus down here. There's another breath bus. At the bottom, we've got the bass tracks, bass, and then you've got the octave lower bass track with this crazy octave pedal on, which I'll get into later on. Then there's the magic bus, and the magic bus is full of good things, good notes. That's why it's green. Then there's the vox bus, which is kind of where most of the bulk of the stuff happens. And then there's the lead bus and the Ella bus, and I'll explain what those are later on. To just talk you through how this whole thing worked, because it was a really surreal experience, the whole thing. But the first thing I did for Moon River is I had an idea, and all the best things start with having an idea. And my idea was I wanted to ask lots of different people to send me moons, send me their own moon videos from wherever they were in the world, friends and Jesse collaborators from around the globe. And I wanted to make this great big collage of moons, which was a little ambitious, to be frank. But that's exactly what I did. And so I sent a lot of texts out. I made a list of people I wanted to text. I texted those people. And I received moon after moon after moon, 150 moons in total. It was a really extraordinary experience. And here in Finder, I can show you this. I've got my moon videos folder, and as you can see, there are lots of them. There's 151 moons in total, and they're from all sorts of different kinds of people. Just to sort of play you some, these are actually on my Instagram story today. So if you're watching this today live, then you can go check that out if you haven't already. But here is, there you go. There's Chris Martin, my friend. He's in a band called Coldplay, and then is Corey Henry. Look at him, he's great. And then here's David Crosby. What a legend. Amazing. Here's Mr. Caesar. Not bad in the slightest, that's a G. Very nice, I appreciate that. Eric Whittaker, who is basically a real-life Prince Charming. He's also like one of my favorite choral composers. So if you don't know him, then you should go and check him out. Scrolling down, there's Jojo. Looks like standing outside a club of some sort. Jonah from Journey Loops. Kimbra, one of my favorite artists in the whole world. She was actually my Spotify Artist of the Decade, Kimbra, funnily enough. Jules Buckley, the conductor of the Metropole Orchestra. Smash. And then let me see, Laura Rivula. Leanne La Havas. Man, this is wonderful. There's my mum. Mike League from the band Snarky Puppy. Singing a D. There's Charlie Puth. Quincy Jones. Dolla Sign. Tori Kelly. Steve Vai. And what I appreciate the most about Steve Vai's moon is just the crossfade. That is so classy. So if you ever send a moon to somebody, do it with a crossfade. Thank you. So I then dragged all of those into a logic session, which I've minimized just right here. It's a different logic session from the main logic session. And this is all of the moons. We're going to spinny wheel for a second. Oh, no, we're not. It's all good. And this is, yeah, this is all the moons. And this actually took a lot of work because every single voice has a different flavor. And I wanted to make sure that all of the kind of narrative sonically was correct. So I organized every single person into notes. And as you can see, I've got these folders going here too. F, G, A, E flat, D, C. And then there's B flat 2, F2. And four people did B flat 1. Can you believe that? I'm just gonna put my headphones on so I can actually hear what's going on. Yeah, so isn't that just like crazy? So these people are, this is my friend Terrell. It's just basically a rumble. RN. So Terrell's in a choir called the Aeolians of Oakwood University. RN's in an orchestra called the Metropole Orchestra. Alvin is in the group Take Six, Acapella group Take Six. And Hans Zimmer is a very, very famous composer, film composer, who's also a massive legend. So, I don't know if you can see these guys down here, but here they are. So those guys at the bottom, and at the top, if I show you who this is, so this is Celine, and she did B flat 5. And so it kind of, all these different notes basically are arranged low to high. And it was so like moving to put all these people in one logic session, because these are such special people to me. Some of them I've met like really recently, just met in 2019. Some of them I've known for my whole life, like people in my family and like really old family friends, heroes of mine, old teachers of mine. It was a really cool experience just to sit and organize these like beloved voices, and they all had their own moon. It was wonderful. And then what I did is I drenched everybody in a reverb in this plugin called Altiverb. I don't know if you know Altiverb, but I actually did this. I collated the moon videos on the same day that the Notre Dame fire happened, and so I figured I'd put them all in the Notre Dame. And so everyone's actually singing in the Notre Dame, which is a really special thing because this room is no longer really the same anymore. But the way this plugin works essentially is it's as I say called Altiverb, and you go and like shoot a gun in rooms and capture the reverb frequency response, and then you can put things within that response wherever that thing is in the world, and it will be as though it's in that room. So someone went and captured the Notre Dame as a space, and I filled it with moons. So that's really cool. it's great. And actually, I didn't have to do too much tuning and skullduggery with this stuff, because I actually said to everyone, can you please send me a note that's in the B-flat major scale? And almost everybody did that. And some people needed a little bit of bias, but that's fine. So anyway, literally all these people are sitting here as individual moons. And maybe you can see, yeah, there are the waveforms. Beardy Man, Chris Thiele, Avery Wilson, Sam Amidon. And the other thing that was tricky about this is I kind of had to scrub all of these tracks, because a lot of them had like, which is what you get when you put a phone in, when you put something in a phone, it goes. And some people, like Jojo for example, who are outdoors when recording their moons, it's a very inconsiderate location because it's like, and so I had to do some removal of that. And luckily there's a plugin, well it's not really a plugin, it's like an application called RX. I don't even know about RX. I just hope RX. But basically you open a file. I'll do it now for you. So who shall I open? Let's open Quincy's. So I'm going to do Shift Q, which is how I open files. And here he is, Mr. Jones. And I can select like portions of his frequency. And if I want to, I can just delete them. And so this has been incredible, especially for orchestral mixing, because you can really get inside chords. And if someone like went like in the middle of a really beautiful, slow, sentimental chord, you can remove said squeak and remain victorious. So that's that. This is the first like minute and a half of the video. For the album version, I condensed all of these into about 30 seconds. It's all the same voices. It's just, it happens really fast. It's like one omnichord. But for the video, this is what happened. And I sent this Logic session to my friends in Los Angeles, Matt, Celia, and Rocky, and all the boys at Lights LVR, and they helped me make the video for this. And essentially, I sent them this entire folder of moons, and we matched every single video to the time code of the Logic session. So it's just this insane grid-based kind of system, and it was so crazy because it actually, I believe it took about 90 seconds to render every frame of this for the opening of the video. There are 30 frames in a second. That's a lot of time. And so yeah, I have to say that those guys are real champions. I wanted to just show you the it's in here somewhere. Here we go, Moon River Final. Here's the video. So yeah, if you haven't seen the video, they're all my mates. And they all are. They're mooning to their heart's content, so to speak. And every single one was masked. They was masked independently from each other, and also has a specific amount of glow. Like, this is Tom Misch, and look at him glow. But that glow was like basically hand drawn. JoJo's phone cut off at the top of her face, which is why she is like a bit of a cracked egg. But it was such a crazy experience to do this. A lot of CPU power. And this is before we get into the real arrangement, though. This is just the first chord. So first chord, we've done the first chord. Let's go. How to do that? I don't understand. That's amazing. So now we're going to close this session, but I don't need to save it. And we're going to jump into the actual arrangement of this. I haven't really prepared much explanation for this, but I can kind of talk you through the basic structure of the thing. So as far as I'm aware, there are four verses to my arrangement of Moon River. And each verse is like in a different key, I suppose, which is something I like to do. I like to change key sometimes. And you can quote me on that. And so I'll talk you through the basic key center structure of this thing. I guess it's worth mentioning that this arrangement was kind of the culmination of a few things that I've learnt in my long and well-established career as a musician at the age of 25. So essentially, the way I started arranging, like way back in the day when I did videos like Don't You Worry About a Thing and Fascinating Rhythm and Pure Imagination and things like this, in the same chair, by the way, I would write these things out in Sibelius, which is like a notation-based software. And Sibelius is great, and it enabled me to, you know, to write the things out, every single part specifically composed, so I could curate everything. I would then, part by part, go and record each line all the way through, starting from the bass and moving up to the top. And then once I got to the top and I got to the end, I'd be finished. And then I go and film, which is like singing along to each part, which I'd by that point have memorized. What I then got into during the sort of iHarmU era was essentially improvising harmony. So you take a melody and it would be about 15 seconds long. You can check these out if you haven't before, but they're called iHarmU videos and they're all over YouTube. I'm sure you guys have seen some of them. And basically I'd receive 15 second melodies from people and I would harmonize them in some way, in some Jacobian way. And so you take a melody and kind of just sing. I would sit here with my microphone. Can you see my microphone? You can kind of see my microphone. I would sit here and sing into this microphone and decorate. And so I would sit and just kind of hear something and then describe it. And it's quite an instantaneous process. And I really sort of fell in love with that. And it overrode the kind of planning aspect of things. And so when I got to arrange a song called You and I, which was on my first album called In My Room, that arrangement was entirely improvised, and I had the melody, which I didn't have to write that because Stevie Wonder already wrote it. Very well done, Steve. It's a very good song. And I sat and essentially improvised notes all around that melody and then bounced it, and that was it, plus a little bit of mixing. And then when I did an arrangement of a song called Flintstones, which is another really good song, I arranged that one much more in a planned way. Like I played the MIDI in on this MIDI controller. Let me see if I can show you the MIDI controller. Look at that. Oh, isn't that great? So this is my MIDI controller, and I sit here and I harmonize all day long. Let's go back to the... Oh, this is a great system. I have to give a quick shout out to Ben Bloomberg, my friend Ben, who kind of designed this system, actually, and has made it work. Thank you. So So I would sit here and I would do these arrangements either with a little bit of MIDI planning beforehand, and then I'd go and sing the MIDI parts, or I would just sing. And this was a hybrid of the two. So I did some MIDI planning. I think actually I might have deleted the... here we go. So like these tracks up here, and as you can see, there's a little bit of microtonal whispering already, you can see in the track listing. But this stuff here is MIDI. I think it's MIDI. Anyway, let me see if I open it up. Actually, that's not really... Yeah, that is MIDI, but that's not quite what I was hoping for. It's just like octaves. But essentially what I did is I played some ideas in every now and then, and those ideas came into fruition. But once I'd recorded them, I always add things. I always think, well, it could be better with this chord here, or I'll add this note and this note. And one thing I like to do is I like to have a chord planned and then add as many notes as I possibly can to the chord before it gets too much, just to see what's possible, and then I can start to take those notes out if I need to. But I don't always need to, do I? Okay. So, let's see. We kick off this arrangement. I'm actually going to take off my wizard hat, but thank you for all the love that I assume you've been giving me for it, because I need to wear headphones now. Okay. Not to worry. Okay. So we are in B flat major. And I've arranged this in a similar way to the last session I showed you, in the sense that it's low to high. So here are the bass voices. So as you can see, there's a lot of concentration that goes into how these notes feel. It, like, in the sense that I could write the note, you know, I could say like B flat and then E flat with a little B flat on the top and then D, G. But that doesn't really describe what these notes are doing in the chord. It's a lot more subtle than that, I guess, because this whole section, the main sort of musical sense is dynamics. And it's like these swathes of fabric that rise and fall. And it's also out of time. You'll notice that if I turn the click on, it does not apply to the arrangement. This was really much done via phrasing, and a lot of the phrasing was done here. So all these blue tracks you see up here, these are all the tune. and I really wanted that family feeling of like the hug you feel when many people are singing at once. So here, for example, a little bit more time is taken, and that means that everyone else below needs to listen to that and needs to leave space too. And so most of the time with this stuff, notes are sung at least twice. So for example, this is two audio files humming the same note. There you go, that's the one beneath it. And that's another one of that one, actually. So like the notes that feel important are emphasized essentially by adding more Jacobs. So here, for example, you've got three E flats and two Gs, because the E flat is the most surprising note in this chord, in the sense that A is the bass note. And so the E flat is what darkens it. So it leads it to D, like D7, which then goes to G minor. So I'm emphasizing just by leaning on notes. Sometimes I don't even write like whole lines for people to sing. I'll write half a line. And when I say write, I kind of mean improvise, because I'm improvising at this point. So this line, for example, that's just because I needed to support this note. This is the root, G is the root. And I needed a little bit of D just to support. Because if you have a bass note, you've got a fifth above it. It's so supportive. It's like it's such a nice thing to do to a root, is to give it a fifth to be friends with. Here are more Ds. So there's actually lots of Ds. These ones come in straight away, a little crossfade. And these ones creep in gradually. And they're panned slightly differently. So for example, here you see that these three are panned about 30, yeah, 28, and these are panned more severely, like 50. So you have like, and then come around you. So it's all about like dynamics. And I mean, I could go like forever about one specific chord, which I won't do, But essentially, the way I'm describing it hopefully makes sense. Like, I'm kind of sketching out. I'm thinking, well, it's the same way I used to listen to music as a kid, really. I would listen to, like, Take Six songs, and I would sing the note that I wish was in the chord, like the seventh note in every chord. Shout out Take Six. And then by singing that note, I would hear it, and that would give me more ideas. So I'm doing this all the time by arranging, but I'm singing the notes. I'm recording the notes that I'm hearing all the time, and then I get to make those decisions later. But almost every one of these notes that I'm recording is a really quick thought. I don't sit and consider whether it's right or wrong, or whether it's like whether it works theoretically or anything like that. It's just like, this sounds good, I'll do it, and then I'll feel what the note does to the chord, and then that will be like the, then I'll lean into it or lean away from it or all that kind of stuff, just depending on how, like, what it does. Let's see what these notes sound like. Right, so you see there's like breath, but whereas down here there's less breath in the lower echelons. It's like this, but I needed to like put a bit of salt on, I guess. So it's like, it just wakes it up. It's like wakes your palate up, because this is the first time you've heard this many tracks, actually. Like, up until this point you haven't had many, but you're actually subtly adding the very, very, very low notes here, which is really subtle. And if you listen on headphones, you'll hear it. If you're listening on your phone, you won't have a hope. But really, it's like it's a really subtle feeling. But I just it needed to feel like it was just waking up slowly but surely. It's like, oh, something's moving here, which is why it goes and comes in. It's just this subconscious feeling like you're being joined. Lows, supports, and then it grows. And again, it's all this fluid motion, and it's not in time, which is a really nice way to experience music. Nowadays, people really like clicks and metronomes and quantization and stuff, but me, myself, I'm not always a fan for this kind of stuff. It's just so nice to sketch things out as they occur. So moving on. Bit of an eyebrow-raising moment there, isn't it? I'm not going to tell you what the chord is, if that was what you were hoping. Again, it's like impact. So all these low notes here. See how there's like a, it's like a push. It kind of establishes a sense of momentum, because it's easy without time just to be kind of like amorphous and to be kind of dreamy. But you need certain emphases to lay down the foundation of your experience. So you've got a breath here. Like that, landing on it like this, it means it can spring out, it can spring into itself. And another thing I had to really be careful of is to leave space for breathing, because if it was up to me, my instinct, the first instinct, I would fill every space with a chord. It's just the way I work. And so that kind of cadence, just, it means you can have a rest, you know, before this kind of thing happens. I really like that moment, actually, because let me see if I can add a. Oh, great. What if there's like a better sound? Oh, I guess I like electric piano sound. So like you'd expect it to go. You expect it to go. But instead it goes. Oh, guess what I can do? Show you the keys, camera. So yeah, instead of it being like a B flat major, it's like a B flat minor. But with this thing in it, which is just so very sweet, so very sweet, because it's this like bittersweet melodic minor thing, and this are fighting each other, and the rest of it kind of makes sense. That makes sense, but these two are fighting. That's where the bittersweetness comes from. So you've got a lot of tension, and there's like the purity of the F major triad, which is kind of like you're used to hearing F major because you're in B flat. But then you've got the sweetness of that underneath it. It's really, really a powerful thing. And then when you go back to E flat, it's like you've warmed up. It's just a little bit of cold water. Sometimes it's good for the soul. Do you guys take cold showers? I heard someone say that cold showers are the way to go these days. Let me know in the comments if you believe that to be true. So, more kind of just more phrasing, staying out of time. here we are. We've arrived at the first instance of pyramiding, which is one of my favorite techniques. I named it pyramiding, but it probably has an official name. This is what I mean by pyramiding. And then... And you might notice occasionally these tracks appear, and these tracks just are, they're just breaths. And it was actually, that was the last thing I did in the whole arrangement, is I went through and just breathe everywhere. Wherever there was a silence to be breathed in, I breathe in it. And yeah, that's what I did. So if I mute the pyramids, you'll see what I meant by having the idea to put them in. I mean, that's fine, but it's a little static. And at this moment, after the same rainbow's end, it's like you're rising to this moment in the melody, which is so it needs to have some momentum. I don't know if you guys heard these, but they're really quiet pyramids. Just little flavours. Just decoration. So we've got a few things going on. It's pyramids here. Oh, that's nice. And as you can see, there are two Jacobs per note. See that? And up here, yeah, this little sort of counter melody, which I assume was improvised at the time. I'm almost certain. Slow it down. Lean into it. And then a space. Now there's this difficult thing that happens when you want to add, like, say I wanted to, imagine I'm the conductor of this arrangement and I want to add a little bit more time after I've recorded all the tracks. Well, I'm here to tell you that that's not an easy task, and this is what happens if you try and do that. There's a thing you can do in Logic where you highlight a certain number of beats, and then if you do the keyboard shortcut, which goes, I think it's Control Command R, then it repeats the whole thing you just highlighted, which sounds like this. And so that's kind of how I did it. So I'd repeat this note, for example. Like this. There was a click there, but there wasn't a click in the master. I obsessively went through and got rid of them all. Anyway, so yeah. We've got some nice pyramids thing here. It's very nice, it's all very reassuring. A bit Christmassy. There are some other like moon notes from earlier, some of the moons, but they're in a different session, which is why they're not in here right now. That's all well and good. Now let's go to D flat major. And so this is like the first sort of flex, the first moment of genuine harmonic surprise. And it starts, oh, I can play it on my keyboard. Oh, great. So not that I know what all these chords are, but it goes something like, oh, have you been looking at my keys the whole time? Oh, no. Oh, I'm so bad at that. You've just been missing everything. Okay, no worries. So gesturally it does this. That's what it does. But I had to refine that a bit. But it's useful to think about it in terms of that. So contrary motion is a really strong way of doing things. And you can kind of bluff your way through. That wasn't as good as what I came up with, but the basic idea is that it grows outwards. And there's always a way you can do this, because every melody note works with every bass note. You can always find a chord that works. So that's what I did. I put the bass line down. There you go. Back to good business. Put the bass line down, and then I found, and then I did the melody, and I landed in D flat major. So that's where I stayed for the next verse. Just on that note, I was thinking the other day about chords, and I realised a thing, which is that if you want to create an interesting point of change, a sort of diehard technique that always works is take a note in the chord and replace it with the two notes surrounding it. So let me explain that on the keys. So, like, for example, if I have a chord like this, and I don't like this chord very much. I mean, no offense, but it's a bit too symmetrical. So I want to make it more interesting, and so I take the D and I go like this, and suddenly that's an interesting chord. Or both, or that's kind of not that successful, but maybe with that one it's interesting. Or you can just by doing that, even just like a simple triad. That was a simple triad. Okay, let's do a more interesting voicing. Like let's do this voicing. It's a nice bitriadic voicing for you. G and F. If I want to make this voicing more interesting, a really simple thing that I would immediately see to do there is that, to sweeten it. That would colour it in even more. See that? And then these kinds of battles are really interesting. Like, weird intervals you can find. So, like, this is the reason why this is so sweet. I could do this. Yeah? But that is an interesting tension. Like, Keith Jarrett always does these kinds of voicings. And he could just do this. But he does this. And this fighting is what makes that such an interesting voicing. And I can always make it more interesting by doing this. It's like a very primary colour dissonance technique. I just thought I'd share that with you. So, boom. Back to Moon River, shall we go? We're in D flat major. Last time I checked.
Moon River.
So this was a really prime example of just kind of improvising phrases that work and then harmonising them. So I knew I wanted something that was like a run in this thing. Like that kind of thing. And so that's what I sang. This is what we're at. And a lot of this stuff is really rough. Because it was a gesture at that moment. And I thought, well, I'll do that. I'm not going to look back. I'll just do it right now. There are all sorts of bells and jingles and chimes buried in here. This is a real like sketch pad of different things. There are a few Easter eggs to find too.
Someday.
So this, for example, that is a quote from my song Hideaway. At the very end, it goes, someday, someday. And because it's crossing you someday, I just thought suddenly, it was like, oh, I could do Hideaway here.
Someday.
I'll be crossing you.
Oh, dream.
This is the one bit in the arrangement that is not a cappella, and it's this. It's this down here. There are two sounds that you need to know about. Here's the first one, and here's the second one. I bet you didn't notice that before. And that is bubbles and chimes of goodness. And it's really unconscious, but I knew I needed a little bit of icing, so I did that.
Oh, dream.
Just opens out your palate. It's like a little I don't know, what's it like? It's like non-plastic glitter. I forgot what I was gonna say. So all this stuff is decorative, just to unwrap some of the thingies. And then it goes. And if you've listened to Jesse Volume 1, you'll know that's a quote from the overture. And the... it's a motif that goes through every song on the album. It's in every single song. Go and find it. The albums. So this is a fun thing. I divided the bass divides every beat into an additional two. This is a little like disruption. I like that bit actually. It's nice. And then there's these numbers here.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Because it's world 2C. That's why I did that, I think. It's also sort of world 2C. Yeah. So there you go.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
Yeah, because everything else is going.
Lot of world 2C.
Just Easter eggs. Now we're getting into some stacks. Here we go. Oh. I accidentally went into the mixing zone. This is what it looks like when you mix an arrangement of mine, which I do to my detriment and joy. All these yellow lines and dots are volume. Most of these are fairly static, but you'll see, like for example along here, every bus is very, very carefully automated in terms of volume, just so they all breathe in exactly the right way. But let's not get into that right now. There's a few kind of like sort of gospel inspired affirmations here. That's not them. Is this them? Yeah, sing it, boy.
Sing it, boy.
All right, this one is it.
Yeah,
all right. There, yeah, all right.
Sing it, boy.
Whoa. Whoa. Sing it. It's just to add a bit of, you know, that feeling of being like, oh, I've got my people around me, I'm going to go and like, go into my eternal key. This is like my favorite bit, the whole arrangement. It just builds and builds. I took ages. It was a whole afternoon. It was just this bit. This like... this build into the epic key that we end up in. Because, well, the first surprise comes there. Because the melody goes, moon, river, Danny, but then it goes, river, and you're like, oh no, something's on the horizon. Where are we going? It's like, no, we're not going where you think we're going. And it gradually unfolds. And as you can see, sort of more and more tracks are being added just to grow the sound, because it begins with a mere 10 or 15 and grows into this enormous sound that you get here, which is that is like 48 tracks. It says up here 48. It's like about 48 tracks. Oh, it's nothing like a good dominant pedal, man. Dominant pedals are just so epic. It's like, ooh, you know, bah, you got that big bah. Like if I just mute the bass voices for 1 second, if I mute those, imagine if the bass note was, thank you very much and good night. It's like, it would be like unfortunately final. But with, it's like, it has that like, that classical anticipation about it. You've got these brazen men here. It's just growing and growing and growing. And then we take the plunge of our lifetimes. Which is such a big moment. I had so many tears during this moment. I was just like in this chair being like, like it's big, it's, stuff's big. It's like pulling from the deepest bits, you know. But the first thing you need to know about this chord is that it doesn't exist. If I put my electric piano sound high enough, so like this is a voicing that does exist. It's not real. It's not on the piano. It's halfway between this note and this note. And I can show you exactly how many cents it is if I open up my electric piano thing and I go tune up 50. That's the note. That's it should be. Yeah. And so we are entering into the key of D half sharp, ladies and gentlemen. And it's such an exciting place to be, D half sharp. Have I been in D half sharp since, I hear you ask? And the answer to that is yes. My song, Time Alone With You by Jacob Collier and Daniel Caesar is in D half sharp. It's quite a different style from this though, but you might still enjoy it. So it's just it's like a totalistic pillar. It's like a totem pole. It's a sense of direction. It's announcing this huge moment, and I this was really cathartic singing this last verse. So we pulled out all the stops. The bass tracks here are going full strong, 10 basses strong. 12. I sat out on my own just singing these notes as loud as I could. It was so exciting. And I build it up, and these are all supporting tenors. Now, talk about a reassuring fifth friend. That is indestructibly strong. Going up here in the on the balcony. You got me singing some high notes. I mean, that's crazy. I can't normally sing a B like a B flat or a half sharp. But I really got into this, you know. And when you get into it, you can go higher and higher and higher. It's a magical feeling. It's worth mentioning that this chord here, which, let me see if I can get this right. Yeah, so, excuse me. This is a G half sharp major chord. The third of a G half sharp major chord on the piano. Let me go to this. We're used to this being here, but in physics, in like real life, it's... It's that different. Can you believe that? The piano is a lie. Everything about the piano is a lie. It's a compromise. All the semitones are the same size. This is not the case in physics. This note here is 14 cents sharp of its justly tuned self. By which I mean if I go like the harmonic. No, wait, what am I going to my in my face for a second? Yeah, hello. So if I go, if you can hear that, it's like a, I'm not really good at that kind of stuff. You guys are probably much better, but it's like, it's different. It's a different note. It's an overtone rather than its own compromised B natural, or B half flat natural. So, in this arrangement, I always strive to be justly in tune, because just intonation is so much bigger and so much more resonant and actually inspires more endorphins in the body than equal temperament on the piano. When I say equal temperament, I mean all the notes are the exact same size. It was a premise that was introduced by the church in the 1500s, 1600s, when they realized that they couldn't afford to create musical instruments that could play in all keys all the time, because what you had is these amazing instruments that could play in one key really, really well. So you'd have, I mean, not to cut corners here, but you know, you'd have like a keyboard that could play in C, and you'd have lots of different variations of the note E available, for example. So you might have like, do, this is a C, and you have C, E, which is the real third, and then C, E, which is the Pythagorean third, and then C, E is the equally tempered third, and you've got all these different options of thirds. Just to quickly explain that, the justly tuned third is the fifth harmonic of the harmonic series. So like, yeah, like, if I'm in G and I go G, do, 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 that's like the harmonic series of the note G. This is like physics. This is not very advanced physics. It's just basic physics. And that B is about 14 cents flat in the harmonic series, and it actually is on the piano. It's a long story, but basically if you go up in fifths, Pythagorean fifths, which are 2 cents bigger, 2/100 of a semitone bigger than they are on the piano, do, 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 that B is, well, 1, 2, 3 × 2, which is 6 cents sharp of its original note, because every fifth gains 2 cents. It's you should do some research about just in case you're interested. I might even do a proper lesson about that at some point, but we have other things to talk about. But basically, you've got the justly tuned B, or you've got the Pythagorean B, and they're all valid options. But for me, like singing triads especially, it's just, there's something about justly tuned triads that I cannot get over. And so this is really in tune. It's not this. It's not that. That's just naff. So handsome. So in tune. So I really get into this stuff when I'm because I want it to be pure. And it's not that I'm like researching in my theory books about this stuff. It's just that I hear it better in this way, and my kind of curiosity has led me to the point of knowing what I feel is right, and that is this. And that's a nice moment, because you're in we're in this key. Like a C sharp half diminished, wouldn't you? But instead, you get someday. And there's like that major with a minor chord 5 thing. Oh, I love that so much. So that's what I did. La 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 la. Let me show you some of that stuff. Let me go back to the screen. Here we are. So, here. You're just tumbling through the circle of fifths, kind of, I guess. And then you go like. Which is just like a little voyage that I went on. And there's something so sort of like tintinnabulous about the. Like fa la 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 thing. It's like Christmassy and bells are ringing, and it's really kind of celebratory and human, you know. And actually, I think it's an around. I think it's around. Actually, isn't it around? Yeah, it is. There you go. So the first one goes like this. And then this one goes afterwards. So you get. It's just a nice little decoration. Someday. And now for the chordal moment of doom. When I say chordal, I mean fourths related. Quor means four in Latin, I assume. And I just love fourths. Who doesn't? So you got like, oh, whatever. It's not in G. It's in the half below. So you got. Oh, let me show you that for real. There you go. So it's just fourths. That's what you have, and then we move on. So yeah, so it's literally every fourth note added from bottom to top in a row. Oops, my bad, I forgot to show you the screen. That one hurt, I can tell you, that one was painful. That's so high.
Mika.
Bass moment.
Mika.
That's a good one. God knows what this chord is. Ba ba. Ba ba. It's like a dominant chord. It's like a super Lydian dominant chord, I think. Yeah. Of course, it's a classic. So you've got B flat, you've got, see, now I'm going back to the keys. Right to come back to the real one. You've got B flat, 7, and then you've got C Lydian on the top. I say all this figuratively, us being in a half key, but that is gnarly. So you've got, it's like a triadic voicing, 3 triads, B flat, C, D, and essentially these two notes, A flat minor, D major, C, B flat. It's a really full voicing. It's like this amazing experience. You've got this great big sound, and I love in general. Just I like stacking triads on top of each other. It's a nice exercise to do, and it's really cool if you get a voicing. Say it has like C. Well, sorry, I'm really getting into the switching of the cameras business. So you've got like C, and I say it's C, it's not C, it's C half sharp, very unnerving. You have C here, and then you have like D in this hand, or whatever. Then this D can become its own key center. Whatever else you want to do in D. And this is in C. And they're two separate worlds, but they can both coexist, just like people of opposing political beliefs. You have C major and E major, but they're both really content being who they are, but they sometimes agree on some stuff, and that's the stuff you need to endorse. But it's really fun to do that, because you can find, like, C diminished, for example, if you're in C, and like, you might be like, that's like a Christmas thing, isn't it? It's like, When You Wish Upon a Star. You'd have like, this shape moves down and this shape moves up, but they're different, but they still make sense because they're different families, but you endorse each for itself. You endorse this for itself and this for itself, but they can exist at the same time. I think you get my point. Okay, cool. So let's go back to the screen and continue our mission. You just walked in on me microtonalizing.
Africa.
So,
Africa.
A favorite exercise of mine. Ba, take 2 notes, ba, ba, and divide it by a variety of numbers of notes, just because there's so much interesting stuff between those two notes. Ba, ba, so you got ba, da, and then ba, da, da, and ba, da, 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 semitones, ba, da, 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 is past semitones, ba, da, 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 is 5, and that's what I do here. I believe it's a 5.
Breaker.
And then even more crazily, you've got contrary motion harmony parts affirming this sentiment.
Good.
which is really gnarly and I really like it. It's probably these two, isn't it? It's a six between B and D, or half B, half D. And it's like, it's just the feeling of this resolving is so sort of intangibly, it's like, so it's so satisfying because you feel the chord like unopened in a way that your ear has never heard before. Like the contrary motion between these two parts going like this sounds like this. And that's such a weird feeling because your ear doesn't know those kinds of spaces. It's like, yeah, Barbershop of the Future, something like that. But it gets big as well, so these guys here are like filthalizing the thing, like the fellas in the room, and then the ladies up here. Sometimes I think about like, it's the ladies, and it's the fellas, and they both have different roles. The fellas are going, and the ladies are going like this, you know. Shout out to the ladies. Well, what just happened there? I don't know, let's go back and see. Oh yeah, it's just like a series of descending just descending stuff. I like this one's good. And then there's this one. You know how sometimes things just tumble, and it's like one guy starts riffing, the other guy starts riffing, everyone starts riffing, they all tumble down to the floor like they've been in a great big pyramid, and it's just like, you know. That's what I did there. And then I believe I did an automation on the bass. Oh no, maybe I didn't. Oh no, I didn't. I'm wrong. It's fine. Because then it hits with this massive chord. Oh, wait, didn't see that one coming. Crazy. It's like, I always get, it's like a great big. Put my keys camera back on. It's like a good old F minor thing with every possible reasonable extension pre-super. And it feels great. And then, interestingly enough, the following chord, this goes ba-ba, because that's what these kinds of things do. They do this. So that's all fine. That's textbook correct. But then in this hand, you've got, and then, which is just, it's just unfair. I mean, that should not be allowed. And yet, I did it. And I don't know what I'd describe that chord as. I mean, you could describe it as like a major 7, sharp 9, sharp 5 chord. But why would you want to do that? Anyway, what happens next? Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's like a because after all this madness, you really need some reassuring direction here. So we go like, and that, it's a good old Stevie moment. It's like a black note moment. Back to the screen. And it's like, yeah, I feel you, minor 11. And then it's like, no, I don't feel you. What the hell are you doing? And the thing that makes these work, besides the voice leading, is you get these kind of soulful ad lib lines that permeate, that your ear knows clearly. Like, take my breath away. That's what's going on here. Take my breath away. And you got like, it's all good. Oh, we're comfortable in that. I love this bit. It's not F sharp, it's not G, it's halfway between two. And it's like, yeah, we're here, we're really here. We've arrived in a place that you did not expect. And then, but basically what's going on here is, which is like home, but we're not home, we're at least, It's surprising enough to be here. It's like, that's not what I was expecting to be home. But then this chord is the vision of the key center we were just in. It's like, we could. Oh, yeah, that's right. We went up a semitone. Yeah, okay. This is the vision of. Yeah, I forgot to tell you that. We went up a semitone just now. That's what we did. I've become so desensitized to this kind of stuff. Yeah, so instead of two drifters, it's two drifters. So your ear doesn't know it's in ba yet, which is why you can be surprising in a cool way. Yeah. And so this is like being blindfolded. It's like, oh, what? You've just put me in a great big triad, and it's justly tuned. And then suddenly it's like, oh, I understand we're in this key, and it's so special because you can see where, it's like you see where you're going for the first time ever. It's like, oh, thank you for that vision.
See the world.
And there's one thing I learned from the choir. There's an amazing choir, the greatest choir on the face of the earth, and that is on record. The choir is called the Aeolians of Oakwood University, and they all sent me moons at the beginning of this song, and they also sang on All Night Long, my original All Night Long from Jesse Volume 1, and they are singing an entire song to themselves from Jesse Volume 4, which you haven't heard yet because you need to earn that. It was like I went to record them in Nashville last year, and it was like probably the greatest day of my life. It was, I can't overstate their specialness. But they do this thing where they sing, they're Seventh-day Adventists, like a proper religious choir, a church choir, but they sing everything from classical rep to hip arrangements to my stuff or whatever. And they do this thing together where they grow, like the tone grows, and they save the vibrato, and then it all comes together. Which is kind of what I did here. It's like this amazing, it's just incredible. That's a real tip of the hat to Aeolians.
World is so, there's such a lot of, such a lot of words.
So the bass drops out here. The bass is like, I have no business up in these kinds of chords. Leave me alone. It's like, drop the mic, and then C is the lowest note in the chord.
C.
Yes, that's another one of my favourite moments of the thing, because it's so surprising. And I've been working on this exercise that I made up, which is just, I really like exercises that take you through all different keys on the piano in a nice way, because it makes the fluency of moving between them easier, and that's something I like to do. It's a hobby of mine. And so the exercise goes, let me see if I can remember this. Yeah, so it goes like, basically it's the chords you just heard. It's like, oh, let me put it on the keys camera. It's like, that's the sequence. Oh, there it goes. Because your ear thinks it's like, thinks it's maybe going to go there, right? That's reasonable enough. It's so beautifully surprising, however. So I did this here. I think this is like, this might have even given me the idea to do this as a sequence. And so that's what you have. And this is where I go back to the whole tuning shenanigan thing. There's something I have to show you. I'm going to go into Contact 5, just to show you what's going on. So, Contact 5 is a great virtual instrument plugin. I'm sure many of you have it. And I know I'm putting my computer through it a bit because it's running all these tracks and now an instance of Contact, but it's done way crazier things in its time. So if I need to demonstrate this to you, because if I don't demonstrate it, I'm never going to sleep tonight. So this is an organ, okay? And that's me playing a chord in the organ. Now, I'm going to go into this organ and I'm going to get it to sound crazy in tune. and I'm going to do it via settings, and then I go into script editor, preset, factory, tuning, dynamic pure tuning. I've waited my entire life to see this visualized. This is absolutely amazing, and you can do it from your own home. So, this is a C major chord. And as I'm playing that chord, what you're seeing is what it's what it's doing to the notes. So the E, this is the E is minus 10 cents. The C is plus 4 and the G is plus 6. So it averages all of the changes to zero, but applies the like just intonation type things to this. So just to like, I wonder if I can like A, B this. There you go, great. So that's the piano. That's the harmonic series. Now the craziest thing about this is when it gets into dominant, like dominant chords, because sevenths in the harmonic series are so flat. They're like a whole third of a semitone flat. It's a long way. So this is a traditional dominant seventh chord. And this is a natural dominant seventh chord. Now, can you believe that? Sing along. Sing along with the top note. It goes... Now, that is filthy good. That's crazy. And you can see it visualized on the screen. It's just so cool. Now, just to let you know, like a minor third is sharp. It's naturally sharper than it is in the harmonic series. So if I play G minor, for example... And as you can see from this here, the B flat is rising. It's rising a total of 16 cents, counted the average. So, 16 hundredths of a semitone higher. So, now, contrast that with... This is just like a massive thrill for me. Contrast with... And then tell me that does not blow your mind. This is harmonics. Different kinds of notes. Oh, you hear it moving around, it's so cool. But they're all like, it's just so interesting. So like one of my favorite changes, for example, this is the last thing I'll do before I get to the thing I told you I was going to do. But if I play, I'll show you the keys, Cam, just because I'm playing this stuff live. So if I play B flat minor, and you sing the, right? Sharper than the normal one. And then if I make this into an E flat 7 chord, then this note here becomes the 7th. My microphone sound is in the way. I hope you can still hear me if I do this. So if this note here is the minor 3rd, which is why it's 16 cents sharp, and then it becomes the 7th, so it goes super flat, 31 cents flat. So listen to this. So... crazy. So you got, that's just so special. Okay, rant over. That's the end of my rant. That is inspiring stuff, if I said so myself. This chord that we've arrived in the Moon River is a really, really, really in tune chord. Because the seventh is, which is unreasonably flat. Yeah. So, the chord is bar. Oh, sorry, I'm in my... Sorry, I'm in my original thing. Okay, so that's the chord, right? That should be the seventh. Everyone knows this should be the seventh. But listen to the seventh. Oh, it's so crazy.
it's just insane.
So now I'm going to move on now. But that was a little tuning thing. Like, you guys should get into tuning stuff. It's just so insane. And there's some amazing things you can do with it. Like, for example, if I take that chord, that, and I tune it properly, which sounds like this. Sorry. And then that top note becomes the new root note. Then the whole chord goes flat. And if that's a dominant chord, then the whole chord of that will go flat. If that dominant chord's in tune, and you can move all through the semitones. It's what I call cross-terrain modulation. It's something I invented. The coinage I invented myself. But you can modulate between semitones with physics on your side. That should be my slogan. I'm singing my heart out up the top there. It's another Aeolian's vibrato special. Whoa, it's so special. So now we embark upon the greatest harmonic journey I've ever been on in my short life, and it takes you on a crazy journey. And let me explain why. Because the melody note here, it stays the same, right? But here it sounds like this, and here it sounds like this. So how is that possible? Well, the way it's possible is by some very careful skullduggery and a lot of heart and soul. It gradually increases throughout the entire final minute. It lifts from one note, and the note is B flat half sharp, so B half flat, to B half sharp itself. So a whole semitone, like this. It goes up a whole semitone. And it's really cool, because unconsciously, but whether or not you know it's going up half a semitone, unconsciously everything is brightening, everything's lifting, and it's like being delivered. It's a really, really thrilling feeling. It's like you're being gradually elevated. And it's just like, it's like impossible terrain after impossible terrain. It like comes in front of you. It's like you see flashbacks from your whole life. And it's like, it's a really powerful feeling to just to tweak gradually, constantly. And so obviously that's fine, but underneath the surface, there's a lot of careful thought that has gone into making this work. So pedal point, as I mentioned before, like a dominant pedal point is a really powerful thing to do. And that time was when it was like, but this is a minor pedal point, so it's like, so we start here. That's where we begin. So it's like harmonic major. It's like, it's that bittersweet thing I was talking about earlier on. It's the same scale. If this note was in it, then it would be a fairy, but it's actually not a fairy. It's a more colourful sound than that. And here's my favourite passing note line. Is it this one? Nope. There it is. Gotcha. So he goes. And it just, that outlines everything about that, which makes it bittersweet, is outlined in this line. And then we're minor. And that moment is interesting because it's not this scale anymore. It goes, which comes from straight out of like gospel. It's like a darker sound. See how that note's leaned on? Which is a contrast to this like kind of Wagnerian thing that we have going on. And then suddenly it's like the church comes in. So it's all these different flavours you've got playing around. And I'm outlining all this kind of stuff. It's just triads. It really is just, it's like diminished chords and triads. So it's quite classical. It has quite a classical feeling to it. This moment is the first moment that you have an inch of a wide enough microtonal comma that you're like something here is not right, but it feels really damn good, and it's the moment where we lift a tiniest bit. See that? And so it just happens. It just happens, and we're beyond tonality now. It's not that note. It's not that note. It's not that note. We're talking about quarters of semitones difference. It goes so granular, but everything follows it. So it's just this amazing feeling. And this feeling, I can no longer play it on the piano because the notes don't exist there, but. Huckleberry friend. Huckleberry friend. It's like your family from across the ocean singing, like being like, oh, we're with you, man. Like we're following your journey. Huckleberry friend. It's like we're major, but it's dominant pedal, so it's still tense, but it's major, and it's like doo doo. It's like a nursery rhyme. So you've got these two parties talking to each other. You've got Huckleberry Friend waiting around the bend, finding Rainbow's End, and it's like these two entities are like becoming one. It's like this great big like victory march. It's not really a victory march. It's like a kind of like, it's like you see, it's like the world is, it's like you see the end of the rainbow. I think that's what it is. And here we go up another notch, and I believe now we've actually hit a real note. Oh no, we haven't. It's a hoax, we have not. No. Oh no, I know why. Because there you go. Yeah. Our beloved B natural. So just to explain what's happened there, we've gone from being in essentially D half sharp major, and we've now gone up to, actually that's a bad way of putting it. So the note is B half flat. That's the note. It sounds like this. And so we started in this crazy place, remember? And now we're here. And this like F sharp minor 11 is such a nice chord. So being an F sharp minor 11 is reassuring enough. But when it comes out of the blue like this, and so you're brightening, you're just brightening so gradually. That's the note. And then, and it's, you know, it's like seeing home, because we all know F sharp minor 11. It exists on all of your pianos at home. It's a sound we know, and we've been in a half key for about 1.5 minutes now. So it's like it really feels like a little glimpse of familiarity. It's like, oh no, I do remember this place. I've been here before. This is my footsteps. I've been here before. So you're welcomed into your home seeing territory. And the bass note, the bass just rises and rises, and this really is the home stretch now. And as it rises, everything's coming in, and it's really exciting. So. And if you notice, they're panned to different sides. And then we're up another degree. And while that's going on, these are just like faithfully building momentum. This is the melody of Moon River. And the vowel sounds opening from ooh, like ooh, to ooh, ooh. And so it like opens gradually. Oops. Ooh. Oh. war, and by then it's like a war. So the vowels opening, the notes are rising unconsciously. You've got like words of home, familiarities coming back. The bass note, the bass is rising, and all these lines are descending.
Huckleberry friend.
You go like Huckleberry friend waiting around that bend, and the bass is going do 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 do. Literally, it's opposite directions because the bass is going do. And so everything's folding, everything's inverting. And if you've watched the video for this, you'll realise that we're literally zooming through an infinite tunnel of Jacob's through this like vortex. It's very exciting. So, building momentum. And this is kind of like the colour bus. I just, whatever I heard that was missing, I put in this green bus. By this point, we are back beyond normal notes. We're back into half notes again. So we've gone up a full semitone from B half flat to B half sharp. That's what's happened. It's built and built to this like big climax. And then you've got this, which is like, it's this great big chord. It's like everything's been leading up to this moment. It's like, wah. It's another, another pillar. It's another totem pole. It's like, no, we are going home. This is the inevitable resolution. It's coming, it's coming. And then... you got to see, now, I can't hold that note for as long as I really did, which is why I've copied and pasted it. With some skillful crossfading, you didn't even notice. There you are. And underneath you've got this contrary motion thing which is so dissonant but really exciting. So let me explain that. Whoa. Let me explain that. Because the bass is just sinking, literally it's chromatic. And I did this thing called, do you know about shepherd tones? I bet you do. So a shepherd tone is an illusion where a note never stops rising because the note goes, but when you get to there, then it's sneaking in and it's fading out. So just look it up on YouTube, trust me. Shepherd tones, S-H-E-P-A-R-D. And this isn't like a very advanced shepherd tone, but it increases, it's a note that never stops going down because when it reaches a certain point, it does this. So rather than it like dropping out and just it like maintains the momentum. They use it in film scores a lot, actually, this technique. So R is the top note, right? See, that one's crept in. And so by that point you're like, whoa, this is really overtaking my life. And in the meantime, you've got these voicings in there. It's just a voicing that's rising. It's like a dominant four cluster voicing that's rising in the diminished scale, I think. Yeah, so it goes semitone, tone, semitone, tone. That's what happens. So it just, the whole thing rises in parallel. And I couldn't help but add these flavors of notes in. Could you have doubted it? And then obviously these guys are going up as well. So you've got these guys rising, you've got these guys falling, and you've got pedal note all the way along the top. It's so epic. It's like an exciting moment. And then you've got the massive finale chords. Yeah, which is such a beautiful moment. And it's like the moment I'm most proud of in my entire life, making this last chord. That is very low, I have to say. That's it. That's with an octave pedal on it. So that's why it sounds so alien. And this is with a double octave pedal on it. And this is with an octave pedal on it. Because I can't quite sing that. And those are real notes. And then it's just a little support. And bear in mind that E is, it's a half note, but it's justly tuned. And then really subtly, you've got some colourful notes, like this one. A note, note, yeah. So the ninth is strong. A ninth has no reason to be shameful. It's there, it's present in the chord, it's meant to be there in the chord. But these notes here, I deliberated for a long time about whether to put that in at all, because it's such a triadic moment that I didn't want to make it be like, you know, it had to be like, basically it's like a five chord, it's like C5, and just a subtle, and the only reason I validated this is because it fights this in such a tear-jerking way. So there's that. Okay, I get ahead of myself. Yeah. So there's a little bit of ninth in there, then there's the B. And this note here is actually my sister, because I can't sing a top C, but she can. She's a soprano in King's Voices at the King's College, Cambridge. She's a student there. And so it says my recording because she sent that to me from her Samsung phone. She was from her dorm in there, in Cambridge. It's pretty consistent. So she did two different versions, she did both playing. And so you have the Bs, let me see if I can find this. Was this a B? No, this one. You got this one fighting that. And that is like the incandescence of arriving after that much turmoil. That is what, that's what you get. But luckily, it's surrounded by so many other like major notes that it's all good. So so there you have it. We've arrived in the key of not B, not C, B half sharp. One of my favourite keys, B half sharp. And let's count how many notes are currently singing, because there's probably quite a few. We have 72 notes. 70 of those are Jacob. And it's this big moment of arrival. That's like, yeah, this stuff here is approaching like the most vocal notes I've ever had on top of one another in history, the history of my life. But I'm sure I'll top it one day. So there you have it. That's basically like the arrangement. And I sat here, oh, I forgot to mention this. I bet you didn't notice this, but unconsciously, none of this would have worked had it not been for this. It's a timpani note, that's what it is. There's even an orchestral bass drum. Which is just like, because timpani rolls get your goosebumps up. You can barely hear it, but it's there. And there's another moment of impact here. Again, I'm sure you didn't notice this, but it's like, no, I meant to go up a quarter of a semitone. It's like your heart drops. It's like, oh my god, am I in the ocean? That kind of thing. So there you go. Now, just to give you some statistics, this was 7 days' work from start to finish, including arrangement and recording and mixing and not mastering, but mixing. And this is a total of 4,719 regions. None of them are muted, they are all present, which is really cool. And there you go. I think it was the last week of April I did this. And it's like a really nice feeling when I know there's like one specific goal that I know I have to do. And I knew I had to do Moon River. That was the goal. There was no messing around, no being distracted by it. But there's a cool groove, I can make a groove, or I could go and write another song, or I could blah, 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 which is like the sort of tumultuum in which I currently live my life and have lived most of my life, which is living many ideas at once and having to take care of them at once. This was like an exclusive idea. I only worked on this for a whole week, and so I went a little stir crazy, but that's okay. And I came out the other side. There's my face, and I survived it, and so did you. And obviously, after I recorded it, I then had to film it, and I filmed a lot of stuff. I filmed about 90 faces, and it's up in the loft, in the loft of my house. This is my like family home, and in the loft of my house, I have a room with white walls in it. It sounds hideous, sounds like a lab, but actually, it's a really cozy room. It just has some white shelves, and that's where I recorded like all those old videos from the history of my life, like Don't Worry About a Thing, and stuff. Was all done up there, but I recently purchased this stuff called seamless paper, and it's like this great big roll of paper, and you put different colours on, so all the colours in the video are real paper behind me. And I sat and I sang this again and again and again and again and again, 96 times, I think it was 96 vocal tracks. And each time I changed part, I transposed the arrangement up a different number of half semitones, because I didn't want to get bored of it in the original key. So I actually didn't listen to it once in the original key. I recorded it like up, mostly up a semitone and a half, and I'll go between that and like up 2.5 semitones, like 4.25 semitones, because it's the same speed, it's just a different like vibe. And I didn't want to get bored of like these modulations, because, you know, I do that a lot actually. There's a song that I love and know very well, I will transpose it up like a number of cents to maintain its specialness. And if I need like a real heartwarming moment, like if I'm really tired, then I'll listen to like one of my favourite albums. Like for example, there's an album by Keith Jarrett called Facing You, which is like one of my favourite albums of all time. And when I'm feeling like I need a bit of a hug, I listen to that album up a semitone and a half, and it's so good, because it's as though I've never heard it. It's this like unheard of harmony, which is just so rare. And so I wanted to rarefy the arrangement when I was recording it, which is something I've always done for my whole life. And so I did that, filmed it, and then began the video editing process, which was all done in Premiere Pro. And as I mentioned earlier, these guys, Lightsail VR, it's a company from LA, headed by Matt Celia, they were so helpful in putting this together. And all of that stuff at the end with all the vortex stuff and putting all the faces in perspective and masking all those moon faces at the beginning, putting them all in buildings, that was all their handiwork. It was amazing. And I was there kind of directing them and saying, let's try this, try this, and trying different kinds of moons, wearing different kinds of hats. And there's lots of Easter eggs in the video for you to find. I'll do a whole different live stream for the video, but this is a harmonic live stream. But anyway, then I released it, and it was really exciting. And it was, I think it was the second single of Jesse Volume 2, which is a few songs ago now. And then a couple weeks ago, I realised that it was, I got a FaceTime call, and my friend Adam said, hey, you've been nominated for 2 Grammys. And I was bowled over. It was very surreal. But this was one of them. The other one was All Night Long, but this was one of them. And I was so proud, because I sat here for a long, long time working this regiment on my own. And so for it to be recognised in that way was really cool. Not that the Grammys means very much in the broad scheme of things, but, you know, it's nice to, like, go to the Grammys and wear a hat. And, you know, like, for example, hats I could wear to the Grammys include this wizard hat, which you saw at the beginning of the stream, which I'm rather fond of. It was my Halloween costume. Then there's this hat, which I actually wanted to talk to you about. Anyway, this is the first prototype of the Jacob Collier bear hat, and this is what it looks like. Can you see me in my, yeah, so this is what it looks like. This is one way of wearing it. There are 3 ways of wearing it. One of them is like this, and then one of them is if you put it inside out. You won't believe this. Put it inside out, then it does this, which is really, really cozy. It's like a lot warmer because all the fur's on the inside. I wore this like to buy my Christmas tree today, for example. And then you can also tie up the sides like I did in the Daniel Caesar video, the Time Alone With You video, like this, and have these dangle from the back. And that's really rad because it's like dreadlock vibe, and get the best of both worlds. So anyway, this will soon be yours, because I'm going to start selling these hats as Jacob Collier merchandise, you'll be pleased to hear, for your cold winters. It will keep your little heads warm. So that's good. So I'm still deliberating about which hat to wear to the Grammys, but all of that is beside the point. that's all I really have to say. Thank you to everybody who sent me a moon. There are 151 of you, and I love you all. I'm grateful for all of you individually. Thank you to Matt Celia and his team of people in at Lightsail VR for helping me out with the video, which was such a beast of a project. And thank you to Ben Bloomberg for designing a live stream system to help me explain all this to you, and also for building my computer, which is a very valuable piece of kit. And it has 128 gigs of RAM, and every gigabyte of that helped make this arrangement possible. So thank you so much to Ben. He also sent me a moon. I think he's like fourth or fifth in the whole video, actually. Pretty cool. And thank you to Jacob for doing the arrangement and for being patient with me. That was very kind of you. And thank you to all of you for tuning in and watching. I will keep this video up on YouTube for your delectation. And so you can rewatch it or watch it to your heart's content. But in the meantime, all I have to say is have a really great Christmas. And if it's not Christmas when you're watching this video, then have a great Christmas next time it's Christmas. Happy birthday in addition to that. And I will see you all very soon, probably next year on tour. I'm going on tour next year. It's really cool. I'm going to a lot of places. Go on to jcrawley.com and look at the places. This is just the first leg of the Jesse World Tour, second part. First leg, second part, Jesse World Tour. Two albums out of the four albums have been released. First single of the third volume is with Daniel Caesar. You've probably heard the song already, but if you haven't, go and check it out. It's called Time Alone With You. That was fun. It's in D half sharp. And come to a show and sing along and clap along and join the groove. There's all sorts of exciting things that happen at shows only. And I'm also planning Jesse Volume 4 around the shows. So if you are there, then you'll be a part of that too. Which is pretty cool. So without further ado, I wish you a lovely time. And wherever you are in the world, be good to one another. And see you around. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.